Hey guys, and welcome to the course dedicated to one of the most romantic openings, The King's Gambit. In this video, we are going to focus on basic concepts and ideas. We're going to look at some lines. It will be not very detailed, so my main purpose is just to give you a sensation what this opening is and what are the main plans for both sides. So, first of all, The King's Gambit starts after moves e4, e5 and f2, f4. It's a pretty sharp opening, I should mention it right now. Sometimes the lines look pretty crazy. But there is also some logic behind all what is happening here, so just get used to this craziness. After f4, black has a choice, but first we have to understand what is the idea behind f4 move. So white is different, for example, to knight to f3 move. So both are attacking e5 pawn. So we can see that here we have a fight for central squares. Knight to f3 attacks the central pawn, but after knight to f3, black has a variety of different defenses that are all quite solid. After f4, black's possibilities are reduced because now, after the pawn attacks e5, protecting this e5 with a piece, maybe not very efficient, because after the exchange of these pawns, white will get a much better situation in the center. So let's say knight to c6, it's not necessarily that white can take on e5 immediately, but once it happens, well, white will have just a very good pawn center here. So that is the one plus of attacking e5 with the pawn. So attack with the pawn is usually the most efficient type of attack in general. Another idea, after f4, the f file almost inevitably been opened. So what does it mean? It means that f7, the most vulnerable point in openings that start with the e4 and e5, will be attacked not only with the bishop and potentially with the knight, but also with the rook after castling or just moving the rook to f1. So black has to take that into account. Another idea here is that while black is, for example, capturing the pawn and then trying to keep it, white is actually spending the time in a very useful way, quickly developing his pieces and developing the initiative against the king. Unlike Queen's Gambit, King's Gambit is pretty dynamic, because everything is happening in the center and on the king's side. So everything is somehow connected with both white and black kings. What are the drawbacks behind f4 move? Obviously, this move weakens h4, e1 diagonal, and it may quickly become critical. For example, if black accepts the gambit after e takes f4, you can see that queen h4 check is already an annoying threat, because after queen to h4, white no longer has the pawn on f2, and white cannot really play g3 in many cases, because in that case, black may take on g3 and the pawn h2 is pinned. But it's not the only problem, so sometimes white may want to sacrifice the rook for some compensation, but here there is another problem, so queen may take here, and the king is in big danger. So this diagonal matters a lot, you have to take that into account. But another interesting feature is that white sometimes allows black to give this check and may want to do something weird like king to e2. So it is completely in accordance with the principle of Wilhelm Steinitz, which goes like the king is very strong piece and can defend itself. So here the king remains in the center on a very vulnerable position for some time. I mean, not necessarily in this position, because it's not a real position. It was made up. But in some lines that look very similar to that. And at some point, this king actually finds a safe place. But while black is doing something on the flank, white is actually developing his initiative in the center. So basically occupies the center with pawns, supports these pawns with pieces and other pawns potentially. And then when there is a chance, the king hides somewhere, and what is left is a strong pawn center. So that is another idea behind this gambit. Just like in the queen's gambit accepted, let's say, white tries to build up a strong pawn center if opponent accepts the gambit. That's the point. And what is interesting here is that Kim is not necessarily afraid of being in the center. Another version of the same thing is like bishop c4, which we are going to cover in later videos. So here, after queen to h4 check, the king doesn't necessarily go to e2. There is also an option of moving it to f1, which means the king is not so weirdly placed. And well, the next will be something like knight f3 attacking this vulnerable queen, and again occupying the center. And a bit later, there will be a regrouping, potentially the manual castling or something like that. So it's a pretty typical idea for King's Gambit. Don't be surprised if you will see something like that. Another important point here is weakening of the a7 g1 diagonal. So it's also the result of f2 f4 move. After that, there is no longer a pawn here. So whenever, let's say, king castles or appears on f2 square, it's also quite typical thing for King's Gambit. Black has some ideas connected with occupying a7 g1 diagonal, mainly with the bishop, let's say, like this. And the bishop controls diagonal. It may attack the king, which is on g1, just imagine it. There may be some ideas with, the knight going to g4, after that, getting to f2, and so on. This is another important thing to realize right from the start. As for the pawn structures that may appear in the King's Gambit, they are different, but in a majority of cases, pawns e5 and f4 are being exchanged, for example, just right now. And then, soon after that, there may be an exchange of e4 and d7 pawns. So, one of the simple lines describing this is something like knight to f3, black plays d7, d5, active move in the center, and here we go. So normally it's not so pleasant for white to play something like e5 in this case, because white's task is to open the position to get the initiative. And if white plays e4, e5, position remains closed, which means black literally has no problems with the king anymore and can use variety of light squares that were weakened with this e4, e5 with his pieces. For instance, pay attention to f5 square after this e5 move. It can be used by the bishop. It can be used by the knight, potentially by the queen as well. So the normal flow here would be something like knight e7 followed by knight f5, let's say, or maybe knight g6 protecting f4. Bishop will get to f5 at some point, and queen will support it from d7. So the exchange is pretty typical here, and we get rid of this pair of pawns as well. And after that, black normally tries to get this pawn with the knight, and something like this happens. So knight goes to f6, for example, bishop to c4. This is a very popular line. We will also cover it in later videos. And a bit later, something like this happens. So black captures the pawn on d5, white castles. For now, black is still a pawn up, but this pawn on f4 is pretty vulnerable. So in the majority of cases, white just steps back. So it's, again, not a real position. I'm just showing the ideas. So bishop steps back, and then white starts pushing his pawns here in the center. So one goes to d4, another goes to c4. Then at some point, f4 drops, almost inevitably. It may happen like, you know, if the knight goes away from here and bishop simply captures it, or maybe knight jumps to e3, and after the exchange, one of the pieces attacks the pawn and then eventually captures it. And potentially we're going to have a pawn structure like this. So white will have a majority on the queen side, so 4 against 3. Also some nice presence in the center. Black will have 3 against 2 on the king side, but it's not really simple to exploit in the middle game stage. Obviously it's a good sign for an endgame. So the fewer pawns you have somewhere, the better chances you have to exploit the majority. But for the middle game stage, it's irrelevant, and white will have nice chances to exploit this advantage, because black usually cannot push these pawns to get some space, while white has no problems with doing it. So something like d5 or maybe c5 is possible. Of course, white has to be careful, because any pawn move will weaken some squares and black may use it. But this, I mean, the pawn structure you see on the board is pretty typical for King's Gambit, and you should get used to it, whatever side you choose. Because if you don't have an understanding of how to handle this pawn structure, well, you will get just bad positions. Because after all these exchanges, pay attention, black gets a pair of bishops. So potentially, if you're not careful with white, let's say, you may allow the opening of the position, and then these bishops will become a real power. If you're black, for instance, and you're not really used to playing positions without the center, because look at this, black doesn't have pawns in the center here, so everything should be done with the help of pieces, then you will also get a bad position because white will just squeeze you with his pawns and potentially pieces that are supporting that pawns. So be careful with that. And this is probably everything I wanted to cover in this introductory video. So we have discussed most important features of the positions that arise in the King's Gambit. I mentioned already some interesting possibilities to fight for initiative with both sides. So diagonals h4, e1, a7, g1. For white, it is obviously the situation in the center, open f-file, and this pressure with the bishop, with the rook, and potentially with the knight against f7. So I think we're good to go. And I will be happy to see you in the next videos.